Hello, and welcome to Talking Toons with Turnip, the podcast where Turnip talks about the tunes he's been listening to too often. I'm that way. If I hear a song I like, the first thing I'll do is yank out my phone, get the Shazam going. Second thing I'll do is listen to that song 102 times in a row. First of all, how sad is it when someone pulls out their phone and Shazams the song that you're playing? Everyone in the car has to get real quiet, the phone turns neon blue, and the temperature just drops 27 degrees from pure tension. It's so aggressive. Pulling out your phone to Shazam a song is as aggressive as pulling out a loaded gun. And it's as embarrassing as pulling out your bare testicles. It is. It's so embarrassing to watch a man Shazam a song. It's so vulnerable, you know? Because what you're essentially doing is watching as a man admits that he does not know something. And that's fucking humiliating, because that's not what we do. It's just not. That's like watching a polar bear drink a Sprite. You'd just say, hey, cut that out. Polar bear, you're supposed to be a Coca-Cola-loving son of a bitch. A man's supposed to know about stuff. He's supposed to know directions and what song is playing on the radio. Those are the two things left that we don't have to hunt and gather anymore. That's the deal. That's the new deal. We don't have to hunt and gather anymore. We have to know what song is playing on the radio. That's it. But I never know directions, and I never know what's playing on the radio. So I Shazam everything. I Shazam every song that ever played everywhere. But here's the difference. I don't do it coy, you know? I do it loud. I do it aggressed. I get my girl Siri involved. I say, hey Siri, what's this song that I'm hearing for the first time in my life? I'll just be in the back seat of an Uber. My arms in the front seat. I'm physically touching the radio with my phone. Fucking cheek to cheek with the driver. Temperature drops 27 degrees. It don't matter. We got each other's body heat. He tells me the song is Let It Be. I tell him, shush, be quiet. I need the phone to save it for me. I'm not going to remember. I'll get home and I'll be like, let it what? Can't have that. When I get home, I'm going to listen to Let It Be 102 times in a row. That's my way. When I like a song, I like it 102 times in a row. It drives people crazy. I think it literally drives people crazy. I think that the Bush administration actually used to torture political prisoners by locking them in a room and actually playing the song The Real Slim Shady over and over again 200 times in a row. I remember when I first heard that, the first thing I thought of was, goddamn, I think when I was in high school, I literally did that to my mom on accident. We're listening to The Gun Club right now. This is another group that meant a lot to me in high school. They still mean a lot to me, but I remember, especially in high school, I felt really adrift, both spiritually and just aesthetically. A lot of my friends were dressing like punks, but a lot of punk music sounded so aggressive to me in a way that I couldn't relate to as a sweet boy. I was still wanting to listen to Let It Be 102 times in a row. Then my oldest friend, Rudy Martinek, he gave me a copy of the Gun Club Fire of Love. He was like, try this. The lead singer was a poet. He liked comic books and he was real sad like you. You're gonna love it. And he was right. I loved it, you know. And speaking of comic books, we've got a very special guest on the podcast today. Josh Bayer, master cartoonist. We're talking tunes. We're talking tunes, T-O-O-N-S. We're talking about his new book, new books, rather. He's got a book coming out, UNENDED, in which he unearths an unfinished play that his father wrote before he passed, and he adapts it into a comic book in his truly inimitable art style. It is inimitable. If you look in the top right-hand corner of the screen, you'll see that I tried to imitate his art style to draw a picture of him just to show how inimitable it actually is. I didn't do a good job. We also talk about his new collaboration with Colby Smith, Fish Turn Colors, Then Break in My Hands, which is a pie-in to the work of Jeffrey Lee Pierce, the genius behind the Gun Club, who is singing this song, Yellow Eyes, from his album Mother Juno. I heard an interview with Kid Congo once, where he said that Jeffrey wanted this song to sound like something you might hear coming out of the garage of a dangerous neighbor in El Monte. I like that. I'd like to sound that way too. It was really nice talking to Josh. I was very nervous and excited, so please be nice to me. I realized after recording this interview, I don't think I've ever been able to have a meaningful conversation with someone about comics and adult life. Even when I was younger, I remember I had one buddy who liked comic books, but we only ever talked about Batman and Carmelo Anthony. I don't think I've ever been able to talk with someone about the style of comics that I've dedicated my life to. You know, you devote all of yourself to this medium of strange fringe cartoons, and you never meet anyone who's into it. You can go to trivia night every night. No one's going to ask you a question about Chester Brown. And yet every movie that has come out since my 13th birthday was based on a comic book. And every conversation I've ever had was had entirely through memes, which are little single-panel comics. This boggles the mind. Anyhow, let's talk Toons. Actually, before we talk Toons, I want to talk about my new audio short, Clowning Around, which is coming out tomorrow. It's about a clown who survives a circus fire, and it's going to be great. And now, I've talked about it. So with no further ado, let's talk to Josh Bayer.
All right, Josh. It is a pleasure to talk to you today. This is very exciting for me. I'm a huge fan of yours, obviously. Also a huge fan of the Gun Club. The first thing that I ever wrote that I thought was a good piece of writing was, it was a dedication, like a little riff on The Stranger in Our Town. I've always loved the poetry of Jeffrey Lee Pierce. So your new book, Fish Turn Colors, Then Break in My Hands, I couldn't click that fast enough to get.
That's great. Colby would be really glad to hear that too. You'd relate to him a lot. You two would get along well.
I absolutely loved the book. It was one of those books where, you know, you're reading it, you're flipping through all the pages, you're taking it in. Then you hit that back cover and you have to read the whole thing again. Because on the back cover, he tells this kind of fascinating story of being, I don't know how you would describe, sort of ecstatically possessed by the spirit of Jeffrey Lee Pierce in the midst of the dissolution of a relationship that he was in, sort of a cantankerous breakup. But you have to kind of then immediately flip that book back open and reread the whole thing again. Like, it's the ghost here, you know? And you see a lot of, you know, Jeffrey Lee Pierce's words in there. He's so brilliantly captured in the artwork by you.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I love the guy so much. I've been listening to him since I was 17.
That's amazing. Mm-hmm. When I think of Josh Bayer, I think one of the first comic strips that come to mind is one of your first short works that I read, which was the one about the Gun Club, where you're talking about what does it mean to be punk rock to me, and you tell the story of finding the Gun Club.
Really? I don't think anybody saw that comic. That's wild. Where'd you see it?
It could have only been the internet. Engage with, you know, everything I see is basically online. But, you know, I love that piece. I think of a piece that another short form cartoonist did where she was talking about not feeling punk rock enough lately. And she mentioned that she hasn't been reading. She hasn't allotted enough time to reading your short form comics. So you do occupy a very musical space, even as far as cartoonists go. So I wonder, how long did it take for that sort of punk rock aesthetic to seep into your art style? You know, where does young artists turn into Josh Bayer punk artists?
I relate to that question a lot because I talk a lot about how when you're doing work, sometimes your intentionality can really get in the way for a bunch of different reasons. And always kind of working on, I mean, for one thing, you want to get really gestural. You know, you look at Dale Croy or somebody like that, and they're pen's really flowing and they seem to have a lot of freedom. And you start to realize you can, you don't always have to, you know, draw in a very linear way. You can start to draw in a really gestural way. And then the trade-off is that it's very hard to control that gesture and kind of bend it to what you're trying to do, what you want to say. And for a long time, I was just so impressed with punk rock musicians who got a vision of what they wanted to do and could kind of platform it to support what they want to say politically or about culture. So like you listen to Dead Kennedys and the guitar work is so incendiary and kind of surf-like. And there just seems to be no problem with all of those guys fusing all the elements together. Jello still blows me away.
Yeah.
So when I was younger, I would do things that were intuitive. And then it was time to be like, well, there's something I want to say, or even there's an image that I want to create of myself. And as soon as I started getting intentional, I started getting self-conscious, and the work aesthetically would just fall apart. All of a sudden, the gestural lines wouldn't look so good anymore because I'm thinking about whatever the vision was. I do all these kinds of things. I try to pull something from sort of the margins of my brain instead of what's in the center, thinking maybe I just want it too much, you know, to say something really hardcore. And if I pick something that's more tangential, maybe I'll have an easier time with it. And there's something to that. And it's been one of the things that I talk about my students on the first day is I often tell them that beginning students, I think they suffer from a sense of cognitive dissonance where there's what you can do. I think I said this to you when you were my student. There's like what you can do, what your hand wants to do, what the piece is telling you that it wants to become, like in the moment. And what your vision is, like what you want to turn out like. So there's what you're planning, what the way the piece is kind of sliding out from under you, and your limitations are kind of maybe thwarting your vision. And whatever else we just mentioned, there's gaps between those things, a lot of air between them. Yeah. And whether you want to, in my case, I really, really wanted to make punk art that was synonymous with punk. And I'd do stuff and I'd step back and I'd be like, man, that's really ugly. You know, can be punk rock, but be beautiful, like the Gun Club. And it took a long time of trial and error to make all those elements converge.
Yeah.
So I'm 53 now. And when I look at people who nail it, I'm still listening to bands who pulled their act together and put out music when they were 17. You know, I still listen to early Discord bands. And, you know, I heard Guy from Rites of Spring and Fugazi talk recently. And he was like, it's amazing that people still listen to Rites of Spring. And he knows it's good. He's like, and I know it's good too.
Yeah.
And I was 17. I mean, as a teacher, it makes me want to listen to what my younger students have to say more too.
Because
a lot of times you're 17, you have all kinds of things inhibiting you. And again, things that what you want to say, and then the way that your voice isn't quite seasoned enough to say it, that it can really be at odds with each other. So when I see somebody who nailed it and said it made something for the ages when they were 23 or whatever the age is, it blows me away.
There is something about that sort of like firebrand energy that comes from youth. And that's part of the reason I'm always interested in artists like you who have maintained that, who are drawing very, you know, I don't want to say because you are a young man still, but like, you know, like drawing like almost teenagers that free. I want to hammer what you just said, because I thought that you said something very prescient about the freedom of a line, because you have that rare gift. You work a lot with heavy, globby blacks, and you have this thing that no one else could do where you put one line down and it's half of a fully detailed arm. Do you know what I mean? You see a person's arm already there. And I wanted to ask you a little bit about your relationship with Raymond Pettibon, because I think he has that same sort of song Freud, where if he makes an ugly line, then it's about to be a beautiful piece. It could have only been the piece that it became because of a mistake, or because he was using a broken nib, something like this. You could talk about how you met him, when that influence came into your life.
I feel like I just told a story in another interview that was done with Aaron Lang. It might be better if people just look at that one, but I can talk about it to some degree, because I really went in depth in that one.
Yeah,
but totally. Pettibon, I did meet him in 98 when I was 28, and I'd been a fan since I was 18. And, you know, like literally when I was 18, I think somebody gave me one of his early zines, and I saw his stuff in Weirdo, and immediately, you know, held him in high esteem. His stuff was just so ambiguous and great. And I still tell my students, I mean, one of the amazing things about him is what a self-made artist he is, where he kind of built up something that started with him selling little fold and staple zines. Then they went all over the country. Him being Greg Ginn's brother did help with that, because Greg had distro to all these record stores. And it's also a system that wouldn't exist now. Like, if you, no matter who you are, you wouldn't be able to get your zines all across the country in that way. I don't think, maybe other zine people could tell me, no, I'm wrong. But you don't, you know, having something that was both a comic and a zine and a music fan's weirdo publication was great. So you could have his stuff in comic stores, record stores, and weirdo bookstores.
Right.
And, the fact that he started there, he wasn't exactly trying to become a millionaire, but that it ended up just snowballing and snowballing until it's at the stage that it's at now is really so remarkable. So there's a lot of things that I get from him. I think about his work every day. You're around an important artist like him, and somebody, and you can see the way that, you know, he lays down a stroke. You see the tools that he uses, and it definitely filters down to you. Actually, and something I started to do recently, like really recently, is after watching him for a long time, use fan brushes. I actually just started using them like this month. And again, talk about getting away from thinking very linearly. Like, you think about doing one line versus you can put down one of these and get a line that goes from fat to thin, and then you can start to cross hatch with it. So for anybody who's out there who wants to emulate Raymond, you can do something like take a brush and kind of tear it up, which he does. So when you see his stuff, he can use very unconventional materials. I've seen him paint with like weird coarse materials. Like at one point, I remember he had some horrible looking wire brush that he had attached to another tool. I've seen him take paint brushes and cut them away until there's just like this single like middle finger kind of pointing up from the brush.
And is this something he's literally doing in front of you?
I haven't seen him cut them. I've seen him use them, and I've seen the result. Once you see, and I've seen them around, and he's given me his brushes. Okay. I had one around for a long time that he had literally taken and kind of shaved down. And when I took it home, I'm like, oh wow, I'm getting a Raymond like line. Then after a while, I realized that you can use a lot of things and get that line.
Yeah.
And that should be the point. That should be the point. Not that Raymond's brush is magic. It's more that experiment with ragged materials. But on a practical level, the actually, I could do a demo if you wanted.
I'd love to see that. That'd be amazing.
That's the type of thing I like to see in interviews. Let me join from my other device. So that I will subscribe to when I'm working is, let's do an unbroken line. And I always tell students at the beginning, when in doubt, connect your lines. So you can do kind of a contour drawing. As you tell people to slow down, and we can do this where you've got, make sure it's airtight for anybody who's ever used Photoshop, you know that if you ever use Photoshop and then you try to use the color bucket, if you have a gap, like that line doesn't quite connect, when I try to fill this in with a tone, then the color is going to spill everywhere. But if you treat this with the same kind of airtight quality and really pay attention to what happens when one line hits another, then it has a very cumulative effect. Sometimes I'll be doing a kind of a bad drawing and then I'll stop and I'll just, it won't be working. I'll try everything that I can tell another person that would make their work good. And somehow it's just still not good. And then what if I go in and I really try to make sure that every single line is connected, there's almost this kind of frisson that happens and all of a sudden it falls into place. So this is a really methodical, clean type of energy where I'm thinking very linearly. I'm also thinking kind of sloppy, like I'm letting myself, I tell people, you can let yourself, when you're doing a contour drawing, which is what this is, do all of a sudden like have like one finger has elephantitis. And that can be kind of charming. It's not right, but it's also combining the precision of trying to make sure all the lines are connected with the looseness of letting yourself improvise and get loopy. So I prescribe to this quite a bit. And it's like two different parts of your brain that I think are both. It's one of the great mysteries of art is that sometimes you need to go to one end of the spectrum and sometimes you need to go to the other. And at one end, I won't exactly call this left side of the brain, but it is a thinner line. It's got a kind of a weird wiry energy. And then you can go to the other end of the spectrum and start to think, you know, you look at something like this and the lines are so thick. I miss the cross-hatching that Ditko was doing. This is a Ditko image of the Hulk. Actually, he's inking Kirby, I think. And it's so, I mean, this is very Pettibone-like.
Yeah.
Areas of black combined with the thin lines. So you look at that and you say, oh, you know, I have that element, which is really missing from this. So when you look at my work, it's often got kind of both elements going on. I go back and forth and more I try to bring in the big slashy reckless lines. So grab a paper towel real quick. Unless I have one here, 1 second. So one thing you can do, and this is a very Pettibone-like method, is let's say you don't have a brush or maybe you want to get some thick lines. You can start to ink with unconventional tools. Like you're going to get a more, if that's a cloud or the side, you know, the edge of like a rock, a cliff or something like that, you're going to get a much more unpredictable line than you could ever conceive of if you use something like this. Let me get another one. That one got a little bit too inky. So you just take a rag and you kind of go to take it to a point. And if I want to go here on the shirt, I can start to bring these two very opposite parts of the aesthetic spectrum together. One is really like abstract and one is like very, in its own way, very linear. Another thing that I'm discovering more and more, I've been looking at a lot of Kniff, who's somebody that Pettibone recommended to me. And I discovered that one of his methods, when he has a lot of overlapping complex shapes, another thing that Pettibone is so good at is putting complex shapes against complex shapes. Wow. So you have somebody coming out of maybe they're surrounded by, say, weeds. So most of us would probably not let that line hit the leg because they push into each other and there's a risk that it'll just become chaos. But what Kniff would do is he would make sure that the leg was accentuated with a big side shadow like that.
So all of a sudden, especially once I add the shoe on or the foot, you kind of can't miss that leg, even though it's surrounded by other chaotic arms.
Look at that.
Yeah, probably helps us coming out into the open as well. But we could keep on going. So here's another really thick line. So if I have a bunch of weeds here. There's a nice tension between having these elements come together that are almost, you're almost about to lose, but you don't lose them. And I found that Kniff would go and just go to the edge of the arm like that. So when somebody is lifting their arm and it's over a really, area that's just rife with like slashy lines, you can still see the arm.
Yeah. You know, I think that's so important for young artists to see this kind of stuff, just because I think that people feel like their hands aren't dexterous enough, you know, to really use art craft. And it's so funny that you can make such a completely expressive image using the same sort of like wad of tissue that you use to plug your bloody nose, you know, like it completely speaks to your voice.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, there's things I feel like teaching has been really wonderful, because I get a drill myself while I'm drilling other people. And you repeat the same things over and over again. There's like little formulas that I'm following that help me not fall on my face when I'm doing this. One of the principles that I tell people is that, okay, if you look at, you know, I study abstraction, or I started to study abstraction as a teacher, like Franz Kline, the guy that does all the black blobby strokes on a canvas. Mm. And what I'll talk about doing the abstract blacks that you find in textures. And I have a saying that nothing is uniform in nature. So if you have a tree, or in this case, a rock formation, what I try to do is have all these lines and none of them are exactly the same. They're all coming from the same branch on a tree, so to speak, but they're all have their own identity. So one line is like, that one's like a flower, and this one's like a curve, and this one is like a Z, and this one's like a dash. And you can experiment with how close you bring them to each other, how thick you make them, what direction they're going, whether they're clustered and part of a cluster, or whether they're isolated over here. And so that's one of the things that I'll go for. While I'm doing this, I'll say, I know this isn't going to look bad, because I'm going to practice my principle of looking for absolute variety. So none of these lines are going to be exactly the same, and people are going to sense it on a certain level and kind of marvel at it and enjoy looking at it. So those things, by repeating them to my students, it's been a gift, because, or a fortunate thing, because I get to remind myself as well. I'll have students tell me, I've really internalized your voice, and I'll be like, good, I've internalized this voice that I have as a teacher as well. And I've been able to internalize it a lot more thoroughly than I ever would have, I think, if I hadn't started teaching.
That is so I did have a question, actually.
Yeah,
regarding teaching, especially jumping back towards Jeffrey Lee Pierce. So you're a teacher. You're a fantastic teacher. I recommend, I've taken your classes through 92nd Street Y and then through you directly. Mm-hmm. And I would so encourage anyone who listens to this podcast to do the same, because it's really an experience. But you create such a beautiful, safe space. And in teaching, you deal a lot with Gen Z, you interface with them a lot. And I wonder how that's tempered your experience of, say, some of the formative artists that were inspirational to you? Because there was a point in punk rock where everything was so aggressed. Not everything.
But I know what you mean.
E.G. Allen, you know, you had these, and who I would say I'm still fascinated by. Do you feel that you view your more formal influences, the formative rather, in a new light, just based on teaching?
Yeah, it's a spectrum. Sometimes I'll see people I like through the eyes of somebody who finds them to be intolerable.
Right.
Because there's still people that I like who I've had people where I'll get very self-conscious about associating myself with them, which shouldn't be, but then if I revisit their work and I still find it to be life affirming, I'll be able to balance both sides of that, you know?
Yeah.
It's a spectrum for sure. And you just always try to listen and, you know, knock on wood. I had so many years where I didn't consider any of the nearly as many of the social politics around people that I would show, that I'm more than happy to make up for it now. I mean, I still will kind of blunder sometimes, you know, just showing Philip Guston not right. in the correct context can be triggering for people. So I'm always trying to listen, and I really like that process. I really like the way it's changed me. First time I encountered the prospect of asking people their pronouns in class, it wasn't something I was familiar with or I had a background in. And since then I learned I had friends who were trans. But at the time, it was so new to me, and I didn't want to be patronizing and ask people their pronouns in a way that didn't seem authentic. And I eventually, so the first time you ever do it, you feel a little bit like a fraud if you aren't from that, if you're not from the LGBTQ spectrum, perhaps. And eventually, I made it just a part of my vocabulary. There's a lot of other things as well. I don't want to pat myself on the back and say that I'm so progressive, but I do try to be aware, and I'm always trying to become more aware. And rather than worrying that it's going to stop you cold, I think it's usually just broadened my vocabulary, my ability to reason and think. And when I talk about presenting the body now, I try to be aware that if I'm showing an athletic body, that I can be exclusionary to some degree, and I'd at least like to acknowledge it. If I'm talking about gender norms, I like to acknowledge that as well. And so far, that's been enough. If I'm showing people how to do a face, I try to question like what the whole idea is of something being conventionally beautiful. You know, that's a very problematic term in some ways. So, but I'll teach people that. I mean, you look at traditions for creating kind of, like, you look at old comics, and it would be like they'd have the same face for every woman. It was always like Betty Veronica, Wonder Woman, Love and Rockets. They all have those tiny noses, little lipsticky lips, big eyes. And over again, you see that, and there'll be little variations. You'll have this where somebody has wavy hair or short hair, and then it's a different character. But while you might want to say, hey, aren't there other faces to draw? Aren't there people who would have more character, who are older, who are less idealized? Still, this is kind of a good thing to know how to do. I don't think everybody has to look like this by any extent. But then you have tattoo traditions and other traditions where people want to know how to do this. So and then as far as other artists go, sure. I don't want to pick on anybody.
Right.
But it's an ongoing process of reevaluating people. I remember in the 80s reading a column in Maximum Rock and Roll about G.G. Allen while he was still alive, I think, or maybe it's right after he died. And somebody was like, I'm really alienated by people who normalize G.G. Allen. He's a rapist. He is the worst person imaginable. He's a self-confessed rapist. And for I went out to the world being like, she's so right. I'm going to I think it's more important to be horrified by him than anything else. And then you go out and you see that, like, I remember reaching a point where I was like, I saw the way people could joke about G.G. Allen and he became a cultural reference point where I had a choice to make. Like, do I want to be serious about this and really think about the, you know, the sobering reality of him being such an abuser? Or do I want to be able to play with this icon? And everybody can make up their mind for themselves. I think it's been weird. In some ways, that a lot of people haven't caught up with that columnist from Max from Rock and Roll, that people sort of, you understand when somebody's talking about G.G. Allen sometimes, that they're just talking about him as an image and him as something which is so ridiculous and loud and disgusting. And there's something, you know, end up asking yourself, which way do I want to fall on this? What side of the equation do I want to fall on?
That's, yeah. And speaking sort of specifically to the tutorial that you're doing here, where you were showing us the face, one of my very close friends and coworkers is a trans woman. And I wanted to do a drawing for her because she left the restaurant where we all worked at together. And I was so helped by a tutorial that you gave that actually had its sort of feet in both ends of history, because you were talking to us about the Stanley method of drawing comics. You were talking about that old book, you know,
Marvel Way.
And you were talking about the distinct, the M shape that makes the feminine lip. And then you were talking about the hard lines that make the male figure. And you were really showing us how to integrate those two to make a complex and beautiful face. I don't know or beautiful my drawing ended up being, but she was very happy to receive it. And I was like, dang. Thank you, Stan. Thank you, Josh.
That is awesome. Yeah, yeah, it's a spectrum. And I think it's good to talk about opposite principles. You know, soft versus hard, geometric versus organic, warm versus cold. Those things take us through art. I was taught by whatever teacher I picked it up from, traditionally, that male lines were hard-edged and geometric and female lines were swooping. And you can take that, you can reject the dated concept of that binary and then take it and explore the elements of hard versus contrasting principles. And it's really been fun to discover that if you're having a conversation, it goes out of the realm of theory and starts to go into practice. So you draw a face. Hard to do with this with a brush, but let's see where it goes. And actually, Stan Lee is the one that I kind of picked up, even though he's not an artist and a lot of people don't give him credit at all because he's such a credit thief. They don't want to give him more credits because he took so much credit that didn't belong to him. But people who worked with him, he had a certain insight. Some people will say he wasn't an art director at all. He's an art meddler. But other people will be like, yeah, he had a really good sense. He had a good touch. He had a good sense of aesthetics and what he wanted and certain things that worked. And I think John Buscema or another artist said, yes, Stan told me how to draw, and again, it's a dated term, but a quote-unquote pretty girl face or pretty woman face. And he said, and I never forgot it because I had been struggling to have faces that kind of weren't in the middle, weren't long and weren't particularly appealing. And I couldn't figure out why. So I wanted to know like what the system was. And Stan told, I could swear it was John Buscema, though it's hard to imagine that Buscema would have needed this tutorial. He said, and the more I think about it, it's going to get into problematic territory right away, but he said, make the nose close to the eyes, make the nose small, make the eyes wide, and make the upper lip short. Push everything together. And I've kind of talked about this with students and turned it inside out and looked at it from a lot of different angles over time. And I like to point out that, you can have all kinds of different noses and be a world-class beauty. It's not the only dominant paradigm that there should be. So right. Let's say I do this. I already gave them kind of a hard jaw. If I smooth this out, I don't know if I can do it. I'm giving them a real Eartha Kitt kind of jaw, right? And kind of a thicker neck. So it doesn't take too much to pull together elements that 50 years ago would have been thought to be only attributable to the male characters and start to, what does it take before this is no longer recognizable as a female face? So let's try to pull in some of those more geometric elements. There's a good chance I can mess this up, but let's just try it. There's some more hard lines. Really gave them pretty lips. Let's see. Oh, here's another place to do a hard line. Yeah, some of the things that ways that we construct gender have so much to do with makeup and things like that. And people will do makeup that actually gives their face a really smoothed out round look. So the more I make this line harder, I don't know if I can do it with this one. I give him such a big baby face.
I know he does. He's an interesting looking man for sure. He's sort of like Boss Baby as a boss man.
Yeah, at one point will it start looking like a young Terry from Terry and the Pirates? Uh-huh. So we go here, and I'll have to make the eye a little bit more angled. Just a bit of a harder line. I don't want to cheat and put a little dash there.
Yeah.
But I give him, let's see, a little bit of a straighter line on the mouth.
I tell you, I would be very interested to read a narrative about this man.
All right, let me take away. So I gave them this real, this is it, I think. I gave them that kind of little Chelsea haircut. Mm-hmm. I wonder if I take that away. If that's going to be the thing that really, there we go. It's kind of funny how there's a tipping point. You keep on working at something and working at it.
Yeah.
And then finally you reach a point where you just see the needle move and it goes from one category to the other.
That's so interesting. So I was going to ask you, I think that we all consume writing, we all consume film. And I think that there's an understanding that for that kind of an artistic personality, you kill your darling, to borrow the famous quote. You throw away a lot of ideas that don't flesh out. But I think that one thing that's so powerful to me about your work, I can't imagine what an abandoned Josh Bayer piece looks like, just because you have the ability to transform and to continue on page. Do you find that you throw away, that you ever start a drawing that you find is completely unsuccessful, even now?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Really? 100%. I mean, that image that I flashed on the screen before was actually not, I like the sketchbook a lot. There's some good stuff in here. But there was one image, this one. This has always bothered me. I did this as a demo in class. I just added a little bit of hatching to this, and I'm actually really liking it a lot more. It It is. No, I have a lot of identity crises with my work. I have a picture around here. I'm always trying to go for control, and I'm always shocked when people, like when I did that book about Jeffrey Lee Pierce, fish breaking my hands, or what was it called?
Yeah, the fish turned colors and breaking my hands.
It was like Aaron Lang, who asked me to do it, he said, I want this style. And he showed me an image, and it was actually a page that I rejected from Tomorrow Forever, but which I think I put online or something. And it was an easy style for me to do because it was really rough and full of mistakes. So I'm definitely constantly at war with myself. I mean, my new book, I wonder if I had allowed myself to do a bunch of pages where I had thick, messy lines instead of trying to have thinner lines, if I would have had an easier time, if it would have been truer to me, etc. By the way, real quick, what I'm doing right now, this is the good example of the fan brush. So cross-hatching can be really tedious. It's usually like that, right?
Right.
And Pettibone will use tool. You can see it in his work when he discovered it. Like there's a period in his early work where his artwork is really thin, and I mean, the lines are really thin, and he's doing great hatching, but it's very, very deliberate. And there's this another point in the early 90s when his lines got really thick and he stopped caring as much about that really short precision. And I think that might be a period where he's starting to do this. And instead of doing one line after the other, he's using a fan brush and getting a bunch of lines at once. And like I said, I've seen the evidence in his studio. So, and when you do it, you're like, God, why not? Why do crosshatch lines have to be done in the hardest way possible?
Right. Man, that is so interesting. I work a lot with crosshatching because I do all, I do complete nib, you know, I use one tool. I don't know why I'm so chained to it. I'm trying to break myself of it and use more markers and stuff like that. But I'm always just obsessed by your detail and shading. I don't know if I've ever shown you, but I actually got one of your original pieces up here that I keep right by my drawing desk.
I think you did. What is it again? Oh, it's a fight scene, right?
Yeah.
Like Blassie? Did you buy that from me years ago?
From 2013.
Oh my gosh. Wow. How old are you then?
I'm 30.
So you were like 23 then or something. No, you were 20.
Yeah, 20. But yeah, that is something I look at all the time, and I always find something new in it. And you do a great tutorial when you teach that is actually Popeye tutorial where you're showing the little bubble heads for how to make a crowd scene, how simple you can make it and really layer a bunch of people into a scene. It's that meant a lot to me because I got that a while back from another Ohio artist, Matt Kish.
Oh, Matt Kish is one of my favorite people.
Yeah, he's such a sweetheart. I got this piece from him. So I got it, and then, you know, I continued to take your class, and then I got a whole new context on it. So it totally changed my perspective on that piece. So I definitely love that one. And you're right above Elvis here. I don't know if you see him too, but you're in good company.
That's awesome. Is that Elvis holding hands, shaking hands with Nixon?
No, it's actually it's just him. He just put out Suspicious Minds. My brother gets a bunch of old magazines, and he framed that old ad for me because he knows I love Elvis.
I love Elvis too. Yeah, I'll show you something really cool. Hold on one second. I don't know if you know this or maybe if you ever heard me mention it, but I'm a really big fan of getting old calendars because years repeat. So this year, 2023, has been consistent with 1978. So I've got the 1978
album,
and this is this month. So here's today in 1978. Monday was the 21st, and it is again. So every year you can do a search and Google what year is consistent with 2024. Like what this year it was like 1997, and a bunch of 2002 something. I'm just saying off the top of my head, and depending on what was going on in the culture, you can get a really cool calendar. Unfortunately, like if Star Wars was really big in 78, because they didn't have time to make the calendars for 77, those are going to be super, super expensive, because it's not just weirdos who want old calendars like me who want them. Star Wars things are really collectible to all kinds of people. If you brainstorm, you can come up with all kinds of cool stuff that you could get a calendar of.
That's so cool. It was just Elvis's anniversary of his passing, actually. And for years, I've worked at this same restaurant in New Orleans called Boucherie, and I run their radio. So I was doing the King radio all day, and I had not just like the Elvis tracks, but you got to throw in the odd Elvis's Everywhere, Mojo Nixon. I had spaced out through it the entire, did you ever hear that Residence album where they're talking about the baby king? There was a baby who wanted to be king. He wanted to be king because that's the best thing you could ever be. You should check it. You would love it. It's the Residents talking Elvis. But I know I don't want to keep you too long because I know that you got other interests and
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, and I want to. But I should also say, I have another book coming out in a couple of weeks, so people should watch out for that.
Beautiful. Can you tell us about it?
I did a book. The book that I have coming out, I worked on for 4 years, 5 years, I guess. My last book was came out in 2019 or late 18. And this is the follow up to it. So it's another thick graphic novel. And my previous long form book was Tomorrow Forever. And then, I'm a one person operation, pencil, ink, write, color. And, this was one of my dream projects. My hyena recommended reminded me the other day, you said these are gonna be my next projects, and I'm working on a third project now. So my dad passed away in 2010, and he left behind, among his effects, we found a play that he had written. We didn't know he was a writer. I mean, he would kind of make allusions to being a writer, but we never saw his writing. And I guess he had a secret cache of writing, and we found it. Most of it was unfinished, short stories, one page pieces. And then he had a kind of ambitious play that was 30 or 40 pages. And it's really, I'm in it. My brothers are in it. My mom, who passed away in 74, she's in it. And it's that those events from my dad's eyes are a thinly veiled version of himself. And it's a little bit I felt like obliged to finish it and to adapt it as a comic, but then it doesn't really have an ending. It does, but it's not really an ending committed to. And he kind of has it endings scribbled out, and notes are on it, and some other possibilities etched out, but it becomes less and less complete and coherent. So you kind of see him devolve as a writer a little bit. And my dad, I think some of us, as we get older, you become more of what you are. And my dad went from being kind of a sensitive writer to, by the time he's older, he's really kind of making a lot of straw man arguments and really not nearly as careful of a writer or as insightful. And that's who he ended up being. He ended up becoming a writer. He ended up becoming a dad who put up in a working guy. And I think that made him really upset. And you can see that those things being unreconciled living in the play. So I'm his son, and I'm adapting it, and I'm talking about who he was to me, and what it's like to contemplate adapting unfinished work, and what it means to have something that is unfinished that for an artist, somebody who wanted to be an artist. So I have empathy for him in some ways, because I don't have kids. I probably have a lot of time just saying, I'm going to marginalize everything else in my life and make my artwork the center of my life if I had made that choice. And he did make that choice. But and I guess, you know, everybody who's an artist has to kind of come to terms with how they want to balance out family versus making the, doing their life's work. And which one is their life's work? Is it being a family person? So anyways, it's a long book that is about typical Josh Bear theme. So if people liked Smart Forever, it's almost an unofficial sequel to it.
I was going to say, that feels like an interesting mirror to Feff, you know, because it's that same time frame. And I would be fascinated to see the inversion of that story, especially his view of the maternal character versus your view as the son. So not that Feff is you, but it you know.
You know, Feff is virtually me. And
okay, good. I never know if people are okay with being up front straight about.
Yeah, he is, you know, Feff is like majority of it is biographical. It's biographical fiction, I like to say. It's clearly not me. He has a different name, and some episodes he wears a spacesuit. So but with this one, I don't use the name Feff. But it feels like the art style and so many elements of it feel like they take place 10 years after Tomorrow Forever. So wow. What I do is when I appear, the main character appears, the stand-in for me appears, he always has his face blacked out. In fact, I used Keith Giffen imitating Minos to kind of get my method down of how to black out the face and just have the nose showing.
Wow.
And I did that to kind of acknowledge that even though this character is Josh, it never syncs up with you. It's never, for a bunch of reasons, it's never exactly true. For one thing, it's a drawing, it's a stand-in. There's already that separation from the fact. Then there's the fact that everybody has their subjective experience of things. You're always writing fiction, even when you're setting to write biography. So yeah. Partially not to draw myself, not to deal with the beard, figure out if I want to draw a beard or not. I just have a shadow on the fake character's face, no matter what direction the light source is coming from.
That's so cool. I cannot wait to read that. That's fascinating. And to your point about it not having an ending, so to speak, that even just the experience of you reading it is a narrative within and of itself. And I would hope to see some of your adaption process, almost mouse style, cutting back and forth between the piece and you as an adult trying to contextualize what you're reading.
It's all of that, absolutely. Because that's the reason it ended up being so long. Every time, every step of the way, it would raise new questions, and then I would end up talking about it, and people like you would say things about it that were like, insightful and connected and gave me a new wrinkle to deal with. So there's a lot of conversation about, like in Mouse, not that I'm Spiegelman, he's a titan, but it is, if people compared it to that or made a connection, that would make me really happy. And yeah, it's really, really, really got a lot of interruptions in the narrative. I'm very ADD. I jump around, and it's a reflection of my brain. So I've often kind of talked about the Russian doll kind of structure, where often you're listening to me talking about making a piece about making a piece.
Yeah. That's so cool. And I mean, I think that is the destination for Josh Bear teacher to teach within his work, you know. I think you were saying that, I don't know if you said it publicly or not, but you mentioned that all of your favorite work that you found you'd been doing over the period of a year was stuff that you'd done just as tutorials, that quick work, Abysmalation, a book of short works by you, is some of my favorite stuff. It's some of, you know, I think when people work quickly, that's when their influences are most on display, because you're doing something it's like, well, I need a background. Let me show you what Harriman would have done. You know, like, I think that something really beautiful happens that way. So I'm happy that we got to have you draw on the screen for people, because that's something really special to see. So thank you so much, Josh, for your time. And
it was great seeing you again.
Yeah.
I'm going to cut it off here and we stop recording.
Man, what a treat that was. That was a treat for me, at the very least, to talk to Josh Bear. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you check out his book, UNENDED, for pre-order now. I hope you check out Fish Change Colors and Breaking My Hands. The song that's playing right now is Estralita by Sonny Stitt. It is featured in my new short, Clowning Around, which is coming out tomorrow. Clowning Around is an audio play. I mentioned it a little bit before. It's about a circus clown who survives a circus fire, and he's able to save the life of one person amidst the horror. The one person he's able to save happens to be a producer of children's television. So she's saying, this is great, you know, you're a clown, you're a children's entertainer. I produce children's television. You know, if you have even one halfway decent idea for a children's television show, I'm going to get it on the air for you. I owe you that. And every show that he can think of to pitch to her inevitably becomes about a circus fire. So it's a ton of fun. I hope you enjoy it. More than that, I hope you listen to it and click on it. And then a week after that, I have a new animation coming out. This is a collaboration with my friend Graham Gillette. It's called Out of This World Motherfucker, and you know exactly what kind of motherfucker that's about. So that's coming next week. It's going to be a turnip heavy beginning of the month, and then it'll be a little bit quiet, little bit of time, turnip time. If you enjoy this content, please support it by subscribing to my Patreon. In any case, thank you so much for supporting me just by listening. I love you very much, you personally, and only you. Only you, not all these other people listening. Really just you, and I mean that, and I can prove it. Podcast over. Goodbye!